Hello, we are here with David Vliet. Now, many of you at The Haven know that he wonderfully and amazingly plays one of our pianos on our praise team. What you may not know about David is that he is also the CEO of Lifelong Medical Care, which is a Berkeley-based community health system, but more importantly, he's a part of our community. And he also has led out in a couple financial peace universities and has really helped our last class just come through. And he shared how Financial Peace University has really helped him personally and is something that he is using in his personal life as on top of being responsible for a health system's finances as well. So David, I'm so grateful that you're here. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about what you do, or do you want to jump right into this? You let me know.
Thank you so much for having me, Josie. And it's really a pleasure to talk to our family at The Haven and just tell a little bit of my story, our story, now that Isabel and I are married, our financial journey. I've been so blessed to be a community health center leader over the past 25 years. And I work specifically in providing primary care services, behavioral health, internal medicine, pediatrics. We do supportive housing, street team medicine. And it's really a dream because it's actually my ministry. And I love the work that we do. And to your point, just sort of leaping into what we're talking about here, Josie, you know, just because you're responsible, or maybe you're a CEO, or although a nonprofit, not the Exxon Chevron type, you still have, as a leader of a nonprofit, fiduciary responsibility for the organization, and should have some acumen around managing finances. But as we all know,
fiduciary meaning financials, all right?
Financial, sorry. Even so, sometimes the application in our own lives can be, there can be a lack of consistency, congruity there. And so that was my experience. I actually just recently took this job. It's one of the larger budgets that I have. It's $100 million. It's the largest that I've managed in my professional career. And actually what I've learned through Financial Peace University has very much to do with how I think about the finances with the organization. And so we can talk about that. But I have two passions. One is music. There's my piano back there. And I'm so fortunate to be able to play at The Haven with some wonderful musicians on a wonderful instrument. And the other is I love to teach financial literacy.
And you're very good.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And so this opportunity to lead out with Josie, we did our most recent class at The Haven. It was really a great group. We made new friends and we learned a lot. And a lot of what we benefit from is sharing with each other what works for us, and to motivate each other toward a success, which ultimately is, as we'll talk about, debt freedom.
And we even got recently an email from one of our members just saying, hey, I'm still working the steps, and I'm at this point in the step, and I'm so excited. And it's nice to know that, you know, you are helping someone maintain a lifestyle that is giving them more and more financial freedom. And so as we go forward, I do want to ask you if you could give us a little bit of an overview as to what are the steps, there's seven steps to financial freedom. Will you go over those seven as an overview? And
sure.
we'll focus a little bit more on those first three. But
sure. I thought, Josie, it might be helpful. I just shared my story a little bit about what you want me to start with the steps.
Yeah.
Let me share about how I came into hearing about these principles from Dave Ramsey.
Okay.
A lot of us as Americans have debt, and frankly, for me, it was an area of shame. I felt embarrassed that I was in debt, and I was significantly in debt, about $115,000. Actually, by the time that Isabel and I were married, we combined our income and our debt, and it was about 115. But on my own, I had about 75,000. I call some of that my food and beverage tab that I had, during my prodigal years that I carried around for a while, and my more recent return to really walking with the Lord in the way that I'm feeling good about, which has been about 5 years. And I was driving along and I was listening to satellite radio and I heard Dave Ramsey say that, you know, our income is the tool that we use to build wealth. And I come from a background where we don't talk about wealth that much. It's not sort of in line with sort of our Christian values, but Dave's not talking about that necessarily. And when I heard that, the kind of wealth that we often think about and see in our culture, we're really talking about financial stability and the ability to retire with dignity, to be able to give generously and the like. When I heard those words, it was just about that time American Express bill was due. And I was putting everything on that. And I basically calculated, embarrassingly so, I'm just telling you what happened. I realized I was going to run ashore and that I had basically less income than I had expense. And that freaked me out. And just at that time, as I was driving up the hill in Oakland, California, and I heard Dave say that, it clicked. And I began listening to his show. And I made a commitment in May, I guess I want to call it May of 2017, because it took me 2 years, 3 months, 19 days to get debt free. I made a commitment at that time to start this journey, and I really inculcated and absorbed, listened to his podcast and read the book, and it really grounded me in these principles. And I began my journey, just like many, many millions of Americans have that listened to his program or that followed his principles. So that's really a bit of my background on this. But I did feel like as I was preparing, because I wanted to share with you specifically, Josie, about that feeling of shame. And I know that many people feel embarrassed about either their student debt or any foolish behavior or their food and beverage tab or whatever it may be that is, that's a debt that is weighing you down. You don't have to be ashamed anymore. It's time to face it and face the dragon and size it up and go after it. And so these principles, I think, will help you do that. Yeah? So there are five steps. These are baby steps that are based on, from what I understand, the movie What About Bob, which is a hilarious comedy. And without going into it, in order for this OCD patient to sort of get places, he takes these baby steps. And so we don't necessarily make long strides in financial recovery. We take incremental steps to get there. The first step is to save $1,000. Now, I don't know. I think we're going to go into some detail, but on these first three or four, we'll go into great detail. Most Americans do not, Josie, have enough on hand to deal with an alternator going out, a broken tooth, an emergency. And so this, the anchor of this work and this effort you're going to be doing is making sure you don't go further into debt. So when you have an emergency, you can draw on these funds to pay, to take care of that. And I've heard a lot of stories, but frankly, most of the time about people having emergencies, most of the time, Josie, it's under $1,000. And so what you do in your, so it's got some statistical, in my opinion, validity, frankly. So with that first $1,000, it may take you a while to earn that. As Dave says, you're gonna maybe have a garage sale, sell the cat, whatever you need to do to get that $1,000, we wouldn't sell our cat Romeo, but whatever you need to do to get that $1,000, get that in the bank, and that's gonna be your platform for your debt freedom, because you're not gonna use your credit cards anymore or borrow money from Uncle Willie or whoever in order to address that issue that you may have. And so that can take a few weeks. You start there, and all these principles will be giving you the details and the name of the book that you can buy from Dave Ramsey directly. And you can absorb these. The second one is to pay off all debt except your house using the debt snowball methodology. Now, I don't own a home, so I am completely out of debt. I rent, and at some point, my lovely wife and I will purchase a home, and we'll have the cash on hand to do most of that. But this debt snowball is a way of taking it. It builds momentum. Basically, what you do is you pay your smallest debt first. Then you retire that. Next one, retire that. And you're using the money that you spent on the first two, and you keep on going. And the psychology is here, and it's true, folks. You get a little sense of victory when you get that first thing out of the way, then the second thing out of the way, then the third larger one. And then that basically leaves you the large, the bolus of what you have to pay off remains. And so it's a proven methodology. There are spreadsheets that help you do it. I used one, and I loved watching that. I loved watching those smaller debts disappear over time. No greater feeling. So baby step number two, pay off all debt except the house using the debt snowball.
If I can just kind of come in
here. Sure.
I feel there's a little bit of me that says I feel like we're giving away the process of the class and stuff. But the real big thing that is beneficial about actually doing the class are the tools that come with it. So you get access to watching the videos over and over again. You get the financial tools that help you decide how to pay off debt, what to pay off first. You get the benefit of being in a class with other people, and there's a lot of momentum that is built when every single day you're being asked about your budget and how you're doing on your budget and whether or not you're actually keeping to it and all of that. So.
Yeah, I think accountability is really, really great in terms of the group. It's also, right, we found it's the fellowship and the commonality around the problem. And then people have scenarios, well, what about this? And I'm pretty orthodox when it comes to the Dave Ramsey principles. And so I think that it's good to keep each other in check about sticking to the plan and building that momentum and sticking to the principles. So the Financial Peace University class is such an amazing fellowship that I think, you know, you're right. We'll give these principles, but the power really is in working on this together. Baby step number four, which is why I finally achieved this. I'm working on this. I finally, at my age, although I have some retirement from previous, I'm now more aggressively saving for retirement. So at this point, we're investing 15% of our household income in retirement. Baby step number five, if you have children, is to save up your children's college fund. The sixth one is pay off your home early, and that's a huge achievement. I imagine there are some folks that are listening to this that have already paid off their home. We still, and that are in baby six or step or seven, which we'll talk about in a minute, and we still invite them to join the class. Come and audit a class, because your experience is absolutely vital. Even if you didn't follow these principles directly to get where you were, what we have found is that some of the great generation, the previous generation, they avoided debt, and they have paid off their homes, and they've got stories to tell. And then the last one is build wealth and give. And this is really, this is where the juice is, if you ask me. The power to bless people with what you have, what God's asked you just to hang on to and manage, and you give that away. And that the power of creating blessing, to me, is one of the most important things about getting out of debt. So those are, quickly as an overview, the seven steps. And you can find this on Dave Ramsey's website.
Yeah, and maybe what we can do is in the comment section below, we'll put the website, we'll put maybe a link to the podcast, and a link to maybe finding a virtual class nearby you.
Mm-hmm.
I know that we're talking a little bit about seeing when we can do another class, but I know with everything going on in the hospital systems, that's just another thing on your list.
Well, I'm happy. We're talking about doing another class. We'll invite our listeners to join us. Well, yeah, I know you'll let them know. But actually, this is probably the most important use of my time. It's helping others achieve what I was happy that I was able to achieve through this 2 years, 3 months, 19-day effort.
Yeah. Can I ask you, if somebody is, they're living paycheck to paycheck, and maybe they just lost their job, they just filed for unemployment, what would you tell them is, through this, experiencing this process, is the most important step to start with?
Well, that's a great question, because so many folks are in a situation where they've lost their income. And I'm just so grateful that we got a head start. I did mention that, you know, there's a step here where you give yourself a 3 to 6 month emergency fund. And for many folks, that's not even enough to pay the bills. But I think the first thing that comes to my mind is not setting that aside, but understanding, and hopefully everyone will be going back to work soon. In that case, budgeting is extremely important. Budgeting, in addition to the $1,000, emergency fund that you establish, getting on a budget and looking at your expenses, it doesn't have to seem so scary. It can be fun and enjoyable, and we talk about that in class. But developing a budget is how you're going to, it's your compass, it's your roadmap. You don't know where you're going, you don't know where you are. And we teach you, don't be afraid, zero-based budgeting. It's very, very easy. Money comes in, you allocate it, money to zero. And then you've covered all of your expenses. So, one of the things that's really important when you do budgeting is look at the expenses and you can see where things are going. If it's eating out or ordering in, but budgeting is a very scary word for most Americans. And they talk about this in class too. There's probably somebody in your family who might like, of the two of you, or whatever your relationship may be, one of you may enjoy being the budgeteer. That's me. I love managing the budget. I've learned, I didn't like it in the beginning, but looking at expenses and then reducing those expenses, are critically important. And then as you begin through budgeting, you actually budget the debt payments that you're going to be making through the budgeting process. So you will need to go through and do some things to reduce expenses. And in some cases, without getting too far into it, Josie, you may need to look at your income before this all hit. There were lots of opportunities to have a side hustle. And even I have a side hustle, believe it or not. I had a side hustle leading up to this process, getting debt-free, some consulting and stuff. But that additional income may be an important reality that you'll have to face, that you may need in order to achieve this. As Dave says about debt, two things. One is, it's so easy to get in, but hard to get out. You ever have one of those Chinese finger traps? You get your fingers in, you can't get out? It slides in really easily, but once you get, that's debt. Once you fall into the debt trap, it's hard to walk out. The other principle is, the larger the shovel income, the more quickly you can dig out of the hole, which is debt. So in some cases, an additional side hustle, additional income is going to be important. And maybe it is selling the cat and having a garage sale, staying out of restaurants, or staying away from Grubhub, or whatever it may be, online buying. But the budget is going to be your guide for that. And we make it simple. And there's an app, too, that you can use. But we make it simple in our class, I think, Josie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That Every Dollar app kind of helps you distinguish what categories in general do I need to account for these items, and then anything else, like there's a miscellaneous, there's mm-hmm. fun money type of thing.
Fun money, funny for treats.
and then also, say I am in step number two, which is get out of debt quickly, and then mm-hmm. all of a sudden I'm finding myself in a place where I cannot at this time fully get out of debt because I just lost my job, or my hours have been flexed, my time, my ability to work has been decreased. Where do I put my focus? Am I still focusing on getting out of debt in a time like this? How do I, what has Dave said about that?
Yeah, really great question. To answer your question, you're probably not focusing right now on addressing your debt. What you're really dealing with is lights, food, shelter, and clothing. Those are the things you would need to focus on right now. This isn't done at the expense of your total well-being. This is toward the eventual goal of being financially free. We're in such a worldwide, extraordinarily different time economically. So, different times require, difficult times require different, require difficult measures, sorry. This is one of those. I would say do what you can. It's not a bad time to start practicing your budgeting. or to get on your laptop and we can send you an Excel spreadsheet where you can type, you know, you can begin to develop your budget. But if you're just food and light and sheltering, unfortunately, I'm staying employed, you know, right now. For those of us that are, we're praying for you. For those that are not, let us know how we can help. But importantly, you can begin to dream about how you'd like this to happen. And we know that eventually we'll be called back to work, or the hair salon will open up where we work at, and it'll be a challenge, or, you know, Uber driving is going to be a, you know, was a staple for many people as a hustle. All those things will change. We're creative. We're a creative set of creatures, and we'll figure it out. It may take some time. So do focus on what's important right now. Lights on, food for the family, you know, shelter. And you can worry about debt a little bit later.
Well, still worrying about debt, but making sure that you're communicating with those that you owe debt to. So how would I go about calling my credit card company and saying, I can't afford to make the payment for the next week's, or my loan company, or what? I mean, is that even worth it to do that? Or, you know,
I think so. I think it's important to communicate. You know, when I pull up my Bank of America there, or my app, it says it's already asking me if I need help. I'm like, thank you very much. I don't have a credit card. So, but if you do, look, we're all in the same boat. And, you know, some people are so fearful about ruining their credit score that it becomes like it's a major point of fear for them, and it shouldn't be. That FICO score, as you'll learn as you go through this process, is basically a measure of how well you borrow, you know, and sort of like your debt score, as Dave calls it. It's not the end all be all. So right now, if your credit score suffers because you can't afford to pay your debt or your credit card bill, it's just how it's going to have to be. If, you know, if there's a little bit you can pay to keep them happy, that's fine. Because once this is through, you're going to be attacking that anyway. You're going to set that aside, and you'll have decisions to make about how you feel about your credit score at that point in time. But basically, even as you go through this process, I got news for you. Your credit score goes down. The algorithm doesn't like it when you get out of debt. When I look at my credit score, it says I don't have enough open accounts, which says I don't have enough debt in order to satisfy the algorithm to jack up that score. But we're really dealing with how we're feeling right now, right? We're feeling the pressure to pay. Most places do not have, they've created an ordinance or passed through administrative ways a non-eviction standard, so people can't get booted from their homes. So we're in that unusual, technically.
Can't get booted of their homes if the reason they can't pay is related to COVID-19.
Good point.
And so is there any other snippet that you would like to leave people with? Like, in the midst of all of this, I think about how all of the stores closing, you talk a little bit about online shopping, and you know, there are some habits or some addictions that are acceptable in our society, and one of them is spending more than we actually have. Would you give any advice to people who are now at home and they're not shopping every day at my favorite store, TJ Maxx? Because you feel like you're getting a deal even though you're spending still. How can we manage some of that anxiety that we let go with spending? So maybe that's moved online.
I think that knowledge often reduces anxiety. When we're not exactly sure what we're facing, I don't know if this answers your question directly, Josie, but now is the time for those of us that are home or working from home or not working, to the one investment I would probably make would be buying Dave Ramsey's Money Makeover book, the money. Yeah, and begin to do a little research, and that may decrease your anxiety, because you know you can begin to size the problem And now's a good time to do that. And I think that, as you suggest, you know, some people address anxiety through spending. Well, that's a learned behavior that's going to have to change. You know, we don't say that you don't spend at all, but it needs to go into a budget. The one thing I want to be really sensitive here about is during a critical crisis like this, that I do not oversimplify the anxiety and the angst that people have with their finances. It is, I know it's got to be very, very difficult. And so I hope that over the next few weeks, when we see things open up and we see the curve flattening open and we see the economy opening up, that you'll feel better and that you'll pursue this and with all that you can, all that God's given you. I believe pursuing it would be a really great idea.
Yeah, for those of you, just on a side note, for those of you who are having financial difficulties, make sure that you communicate with your local community of faith. Make sure that you can communicate with you know, your landlords, the people you pay your debts to, and make sure that you get connected, because there may be a lot more in your county. I know there is in Napa County, where we are financially assisting those who don't qualify for any other financial assistance, like you don't qualify for unemployment insurance, et cetera, et cetera. Make sure that if your hours have been flexed, that your pride doesn't take precedence over going and picking up food at some of our local food pantries, our food distribution centers. Our food pantry, at least in Napa, is full. It has food, and there's an increase of people who are now coming to our pantries, and so you can be there. Our local senior center is providing food specifically for seniors, and they'll put it right in your trunk. Let that be something that you receive, so that can help you financially meet your budget. And know that you are not alone, and that your community wants to help you. Sometimes it's just about keeping your eyes and ears open, searching your Facebook page for your community leaders and local nonprofits that are wanting to make sure that you survive this pandemic. You are not alone, and make sure to remember you reach out for help.
I'd also like to say two things. Of course, take care of your health, you know, as well. And there are resources in your community where you can get health care at a level you can afford. UpValley Health is in the Napa area. They're a colleague of ours. The other thing is that I think it's really important that if you need any assistance, Josie, I don't know how you feel about this. I'm not a certified financial planner. I have an MBA, which means I know a little about a whole lot of nothing. So, but if you, and I don't charge, if you ever want to ask questions, you certainly welcome to email me. I'm happy to respond if you have questions about this or my class.
What might be easier is if you have questions and we put it down in the comment section underneath this video, we might be able to take those questions and do another video.
Perfect.
And then that way we can continue in that dialogue. But those who do know you can definitely, you know, reach out to you.
I'd welcome that.
thank you. Thank you for being willing to offer your time and your expertise. This isn't something that is philosophical for you. It is something you do on a day-to-day basis. And that's why it's so beneficial for us to have that conversation with you, because you are living this. You're not just talking about it.
And I just can't describe, you know, there's this delayed gratification. There is something that feels good about finishing the marathon. And when you get through it, and as you'll learn, it's a real victory to have debt off your back. It really is. It's a great relief. So I really trust people will pursue this.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you for your time. And we hope that this video has been helpful to you. Leave some comments. Thank you for watching. And we will hopefully connect with you again very soon.
Thank you, Pastor. We appreciate you.
Bye.